Welcome back, WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. We got the hat, we got the other hat, we got the Tark ice cream, we got the Planet Fitness koozie, and we got Chicken Palooza going on all month. This is actually my box, Luke. I went on Friday night. It was too damn hot to cook. There were Western fries in here, and I think the lady liked me because I think she gave me a couple extra.
There you go.
Yeah, so, you know, I got the two-piece, $5, you know, working on extra fries. It's Chicken Palooza. Get out there. And I want to remind everybody that 10 cents from every Chicken Palooza box sold goes donated to be to help our friends at Johns Hopkins and the Children's Center over there. So, Lord knows my wife and I walked with lots of those children over there back in 2014 and 15 and 16. And little did we know, Luke Jones, that we would have a pandemic and the Orioles would play in front of no one for nobody. The game wouldn't even be on here on Sunday night. And, oh, by the way, football's going to play, too. I don't know if you heard. we're in a whole different place now, aren't we, bro? I mean, we're just like in a whole – not including Zoom, right? Like, you're Zooming. What is that behind you? Is that the football stadium we used to play football in?
That is the football stadium, the ballpark, and the Baltimore skyline. So it's right in my living room. It was a – I think it was a present. Actually, I don't think – my mom picked it out for me. I paid for it, but
– I'm not going to tell anybody, but my home is right over your left ear.
There you go. There you go. If you look closely, I think I could see you looking out the window.
I'm waving. Can't you? Hold on, turn around. I got to go do that the other way. All right, man. Well, I mean, we got a sense of humor about this. And, and obviously, you know, the audience out on the internet can now see us and feel us. The internet has become this place. We're all gathering. We're all trapped in our places. We're all watching to see if this is going to work or not. The Orioles have had COVID in their locker room. Just lost a legendary guy in Ocean City that owned the Purple Moose Saloon. All my Ocean City friends are freaked out. COVID's back. And, you know, I saw it last week because we live downtown right over your shoulder. And we saw the lines forming around the convention center. And my wife got the binoculars and she said, that's the longest line I've ever seen over there. And I'm like, oh, well, that means by Monday morning, bad things are going to be. I don't know how this is going to go. We've talked about this for weeks. But the society aside, they're trying to do it. The Orioles got on a bus. They went up to Philadelphia. They played. They're going to do this with Washington. They're going to go to Boston this weekend. They're going to play baseball. They're going to start a baseball season. Now the question is, as I watched it over the weekend, are we going to want to watch baseball in an empty stadium? It is really, really an empty vibe watching baseball in an empty stadium on television. I'll tell you that.
It's definitely different. I don't know if I'd say it's a completely empty vibe. First of all, we're watching preseason games. I mean, we're watching exhibition games. The Orioles and the Phillies on Sunday randomly played a 10th inning just because Phillies had a pitcher they wanted to get some extra work. But having been down there –
I didn't get any of those 10 innings. I didn't get one inning, by the way. So you live in Pennsylvania. You're a Phillies fan.
Right. My brother-in-law is, but – I think when you watch it, it's definitely different. There's no question about that. But anyone who's watched pro wrestling since March, it's different. Anyone who's been watching Major League Soccer with their World Cup-like tournament that they've kicked off over the last few weeks.
Golf sounds the same, by the way.
Golf does sound, although you don't get the golf clap when someone hits one right down the middle of the fairway. But I think once we get beyond that, it's a little jarring in the same way that I told you it was very jarring watching the empty ballpark game in Baltimore 5 years ago. But once you get beyond that, it is the game. It's different. There's no question about that. All the teams are using the piped-in crowd noise. I don't love that when the ball's put in play or there's a home run because that's where the timing of it feels odd. I do kind of like the ambience of just the general crowd buzz that even being in the press box at Camden Yards, it did feel a little more normal than being there when I was there last Tuesday night and there was no crowd noise being piped in at all and it was just dead
silent. But you're the only one hearing it. Can you hear it on TV? You know what I mean? Like, I don't really care whether you're having a good time in the press box as one of 15 people there or the 50 players. I'm talking about the experience of sitting at home and watching it on TV because that's the way everybody's going to experience it. I could sort of hear faint. I wasn't paying all that much attention. I mean, honestly, I watched the Pirates play the Indians because Robbie Inchmikowski was doing the game. You know, like I stopped it. I heard his voice. I'm like, hey, that's Robbie. Let's hear what he has to say. And I said to my wife, I'm like, Well, I mean, they're the Pirates. How many people really know much about the Pirates? At least they've got the guy on the air who knows a lot about what's going on. And, I mean, the other part of this from an Orioles fan perspective, the sounds of Gary Thorne, which never really all that normal to me, always sounded like a rent-a-cop to me, and Jim Palmer and the things we're used to as Orioles fans from sounds, staying with it 3 hours a night and marrying it 3 hours a night and treating it like it's Springsteen 3 hours a night for 60 days for a last place team. I'm just trying to figure out, and to be really, you know, honest, what my level of involvement's going to be once they start playing, and what the level of involvement of my audience is or anyone's going to be once they start playing. Because at the end, you would say, like the NFL, we hear this all the time, right? I like watching the games on TV better. Now, do you or do you not? You don't watch a lot on TV, but you watch half the games at home. Do you really like being in the press box better, being in the first row in the upper deck with me better, watching the game on TV? Where do you enjoy the game the most, Luke?
I would say TV's probably the easiest viewing experience for the purposes of what we do. However, when you do sit in the press box, or even for that matter, if you're sitting in the upper deck, you do get a different vantage point. For example, if there's ever a conflict on the sideline between a couple of players, player and a coach, that's something TV doesn't always pick up. If you're sitting in the press box, now you don't always see it because you might be looking at your computer or watching something else. It is a different vantage point, in the same way that, you know, when I'm watching baseball in a press box, as far as the non-pitching part of the game, I much prefer the press box. If I'm solely focused on the quality of the pitching, being on watching it on TV is much easier because you can see the strike zone much more, you know, in a more simpler or a simpler vantage point. So, you know, there's pros and cons to all of it. But just to get back to my point that I was talking about with the piped in crowd noise at the ballpark, I think some of that also has to do with the players. I think it's a much different animal when you're February 15th in Sarasota and you know you're 6 weeks out from the start of the season, that you're taking BP or you're just viewing some pitches or whatever you're doing in terms of a hitter or pitcher relationship there. But when you're going to play real games, not having that ambience, not having that crowd noise, that buzz in the background, I think it's very jarring for guys. So, you know, I'm not saying that that's ideal. I'm not saying everyone's going to love that. But in some of my experiences, you know, just limited experience being at the ballpark this last week, hearing some guys talk about it around the league. And I also think for the TV viewing experience, you know, it's almost like a movie or a TV. We always talk about what? Suspension of disbelief when you're watching some matter of fiction. I think the piped in crowd noise, if it's done well, if it's not too over the top, I think whoever's operating it from the stadium has to be really careful about it because it can come across as really distracting in a negative way. But I think if it's more on the subtle side, I think it can help the viewing experience. Because like I said, even checking out a little bit of MLS over the last couple of weeks, and, you know, I mean, European soccer has been, some of the broadcasts have been using it. You can get caught up in it. If it's an entertaining game, you can get caught up in the idea of, oh, that's crowd noise. And then when you see a different angle from just on the field, you say, oh, yeah, there's no fans there. So I see both sides of it. It's definitely going to be weird. This is all weird.
Well, the watching it was the weird part for me. The emptiness of, am I going to ask my wife to turn off Guy Fieri, to turn off the dog shows, to turn off the cooking shows, to turn off, the nerds, that the Big Bang Theory, yeah, any of these things you can watch on television for right. in the months of August and September? There needs to be something attractive about it as a broadcast, right? And I think all of us would say the last 6 months, you and I are Zooming. The attractiveness of the painting behind you gets judged and the leg lamp behind me and the hat and all of that. But there does come the point where if you're going to sit and watch a ball game, the notion of staying with it and being there for 3 hours and 18 innings and no sound and do I care and is it entertaining for me? Am I enjoying it? There definitely was something about John Miller calling a game or Chuck Thompson or Jim Palmer or Brooks Robinson or any number of whatever the broadcast is, that becomes your companion every night. And it's one of the reasons I just think Jim Hunter and Tom Davis and a bunch of these people just aren't very good at this because I just don't feel like spending 3 hours with them. And a lot of people wouldn't want to spend 3 hours with me, so I get it. But it is a companionship issue that has been completely altered from an experiential standpoint, that you sit and you watch baseball now, and you say, what did I like about it? What attracted me to it? The competition the Oriole had, the player I like, the sounds of the game, the broadcaster telling a story, whatever that part of it is, something's missing about it on TV. I'm sure it's missing for the players as well. Sure. My question is, how does it affect the overall experience? Because I'm with you. People say, I watch football because I love it on TV. I get replays. I get better angles. I get all that. I love football in person. I love my seat in the upper deck. I love seeing the plays. I love the feel of it. I love the ebb and flow. I love when the ball's in the air and everyone rises. I love all of that about football. Baseball, maybe it's because I've been treated like garbage. Maybe it's because I've been to every ballpark and I've been doing this all my life and I remember 33rd Street and I've had better experiences. And it's almost like going on a bad date with a girl you don't want to be on a date with who used to be a good, you know, you think about it in a certain way, like 1979 or 1996. And then you go now and you have a different vibe. The TV experience is completely different. None of us have watched baseball in 10 months. So you put it on. And all I could think to myself is, wow, this is really bad. Like, what are they going to do to even make the good teams feel more vibrant? And the Mets had those fake bodies, which didn't do much more for me to make me laugh. It had like a little bit of a Saturday night, and I put a funny tweet out about the empty seats. Are they stuck on the 7 train? Humor's all I got at this point, and we have 60 baseball games, and I really do think to myself, they're trying to attract people. They're doing this to keep the party going, to keep you and me in on it, to hopefully find new people or bring people sitting home to the game. This would be like serving, you know, Royal Farm serving cold chicken because they can't give you hot chicken and still saying it's cold, eat it. It doesn't taste the same and you might not like it. And that's the vibe I had for baseball, is that they're trying to roll out opening day and bunting and excitement and here we are and it's important and let's play for our team and let's play through for the country and let's do all that. And then when you put it on, every part about it makes you realize, oh, there must be a plague.
Sure. But I would, and I've said this to you at various times over the last couple months, I mean, at some point in time, perfect is the enemy of good, right? I mean, no one is acknowledging this as being ideal, but the alternative, and of course, we're acknowledging the pandemic and health aspect of this that could bring this to its knees in a matter of days. So far, there have been some testing hiccups, but the latest testing report for Major League Baseball has been a very low positive percentage, which was good to see, much better than what we're seeing in this country by and large. But I think we acknowledge that this isn't going to be a legitimate baseball season in the traditional sense. We know that.
It's an exhibition season, kind of.
I think that's a great way to put it. I was talking to someone else in the local media when I was down at the ballpark this past week, and we kind of said, view this as a baseball event. You know, it's almost as though, I mean, we have a 60-game sprint.
Like an all-star game.
Right. I mean, it's strange. It's very weird. I've said that about, you know me, I'm a pro wrestling geek. They've been competing or putting on performances and matches in empty arenas for 3 months now, 3.5 months, however long it's been. So we know that it's not ideal in that way, but if it's something that can offer some entertainment value, and some of the points you're making, we could have said about the Orioles long before we ever.
Yeah, I mean, if they were going to lose 108 games this summer, right. I guess it wouldn't be exciting, but there would be people there. There'd be hot dogs. There'd be bunting. There'd be watch every fifth day when the kid that actually can pitch pitches. You know, there's a little Mountcastle comes up. There's a little bit of all of that would have been baked into it. And look, I've been on the bitch about baseball train for 15 years. I invited my pal Mike Maceros from the Smithereens. One of my, you know, a guy like you and me, like a real baseball guy. He wrote me back. He's like, I just can't talk about baseball. It's too depressing. You know, like, and he's just sort of like, it feels like it's abandoned me. And this is a guy who loved baseball more than me, right? Like, right. And I'm thinking to myself, if they're not doing it right now, and I'm yelling at the wall, right? If they're not doing it for me and for him and for us who love baseball, then who are they doing it for? Because you can't go buy a ticket. So if they're putting on this you know, Lions Gladiators exhibition, right? At least we should be watching it, right? Like, someone should really care a lot about it. And I'm wondering whether Yankees fans all over New York are going to put this on and watch it in their living room during a plague and be truly engaged in it in the way, because it doesn't feel engaging. It doesn't sound engaging. It doesn't look engaging. And the broadcasts aren't engaging. And at the end, they are making television. They're not making baseball anymore. Sure. They're not competing with the girl in the third row who looks nice, or the kid over there eating the ice cream cone, or the scoreboard, or the ketchup races when you're sitting in the stadium. They're competing with the whole world now. And when you put it on and it feels a little empty, and to your point, you don't really care who wins, and it's an exhibition anyway, and it's not a real season, and there aren't real stats, like, as we would measure them, then all of a sudden, a lot of that stuff that we get out of baseball, not to mention the gambling side of things, which is there, by the way, you can gamble on it, from a competitive standpoint, and I was wondering this watching it, where I'm seeing bats that are slow, pitchers that looked okay. It looks to me like a lot of these pitchers literally went out every 2 days and threw a baseball in April and May and June because they realized they might play, and if they do, they were going to make $2 or $3 million to play. And also, I'm not throwing my arm out on July 31st by not being ready to pitch, right? So the guys that are pitching look to be a little ahead in some way, or am I wrong in that? Because I think it's a lot harder to stay on in a cage with a machine throwing a baseball than it is when things are happening out there.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's going to be one of the more interesting debates. Max Scherzer would tell you he got knocked around big time against Philadelphia on Saturday night. So I think
Max Scherzer's got a pretty wife and a lot of money. I have a feeling maybe he wasn't. He's not trying to earn his money, you know.
I think he'll be okay, to be very clear. But I think that's one of the more fascinating aspects of this that maybe won't apply as much with the NFL, even though there was no spring program. But what kind of playing condition are these guys in? Not to say they're going to be out of shape and 30 pounds overweight or anything like that. But even over these last 3 weeks where they've ramped up, what does that look like from a pitching standpoint? I mean, my goodness, Nestor, I don't need to tell you, pitchers, the creatures of habit that they are, as much as any athlete in any sport you can think of, I mean, how much of a routine that is, especially in this day and age where 7 and 8 figure contracts, sometimes guys are hovering around 9-figure contracts as far as the investment that they have made in themselves and that their teams have made in them. So, you know, how does that look? How did that look over the last few months? I mean, to your point, they were throwing sim games and there was communication via Zoom and over the phone with trying to stay in shape. But Buck Showalter, who was part of the ESPN broadcast over the weekend, Yankees Mets, he loves to talk about a player's clock. And what that means is when you're literally in the competition, when the games have started, it's a little bit faster. So you need to speed it up. Or sometimes, and this is where I have some concern about pitchers who, okay, they've been doing sim games and throwing in their backyard at bullpens, but when Giancarlo Stanton steps into the box and you know you have a 60-game season and, oh, yeah, maybe you're hitting free agency this winter, there's a lot of pressure there that you're going from 0 to 100 in a very short period of time.
Yeah, the short track's going to affect a lot of guys' careers, right? Money-wise?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right. So that's where I think there's, to me, I mean, the concern about whether you perform well or not is a given, but for these pitchers especially, I have a lot of concerns about elbow injuries, shoulder injuries, and going from, you know, not that these guys weren't working hard, but anyone could tell you that that's competed at any meaningful level, that it's different when you're in the arena. It's different when you're in the stadium as opposed to being in the backyard or being at the spring training facility. So I think there are a lot of questions in that way. But I hear a lot of the question, you know, some of the questions that you posed as far as what this looks like. And to answer your question about the Yankees specifically, I think their fans are really excited, even though it is a weird season. Why? Because they've got a great chance to go to the World Series and win it.
They have a chance to go 59-1.
In the same way that, hey, but I mean, let's face it, the NFL season's going to look very different if it happens, and there aren't going to be more than 14,000 in a best case scenario in Baltimore for Ravens games. I mean, that's if fans are even allowed in the building. So you ask that question, Hell yeah, Ravens fans are going to be really excited about this season, even if it's weird. Why? Because they went 14-2 last year, and they had the MVP at quarterback. So I hear what you're saying, and look, it's going to be different, but MLS ratings up. The Jordan documentary on ESPN a couple months ago got insane numbers for TV. And I'm not saying Nielsen ratings are everything, but I think you see people are starving for sports. And even if it's a weird, almost like think of like astronaut food or something like that compared to a normal meal. Well, you still want that nourishment, right? And if you're a sports fan, even if it's weird, even if it's not ideal, even if you're going to lament not having fans or players who have made the decision to opt out and done what's best for them and their family, and I respect that, we're going to acknowledge all those things that aren't normal, but I think baked into that could still be a solid product that is at least going to provide that diversion that so many of us have longed for over the last few months.
He is Luke Jones. He is Baltimore Luke out on Twitter and Instagram and Facebook and all sorts of places together. We provide the sports as they get back on the field this week. Football is going to get back on the field as well. Nasty at WNST.net finds me. I want to give a shout out to our friends at Liberty Pure Solutions while I got the hat on. My water heater was corroded. We got in touch with Doug. Doug sent a crew out here the other day. I thought like I was not going to be able to shower for days. I mean, they're putting in a water heater. It's going to take the weekend. 2 hours later, hot water, good pressure, all things going on. Liberty Pure Solutions, more than just fresh water. They can come take care of whatever your water needs are. And, of course, we got that crazy well water going on out on Hart Road at WNSD. So we appreciate them. Liberty Pure Solutions, find them on the web. I'll be telling you more about them. I have all sorts of Liberty Pure water around here, and I go to reach for one. I'm going to start drinking, I think, my water on the set out of my Taharka ice cream. This is vanilla bean. This goes nice with everything. Some people say vanilla. Like, who would get vanilla ice cream? You haven't had vanilla ice cream in a long time. It tastes better than you remember it. I'll tell you that. Wake and Bake as well. Honey Graham, the peanut butter cup on the set. Big thanks to them. We're going to continue all week long mixing and matching a little bit of Baltimore Positive, a little bit of WNSG, some sports, some news, some local stuff. We're all trying to stay away from the plague. Make sure you're wearing a mask, washing your hands. We are WNST.net, AM 1570, WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. Stay with us.